your excellent panel. It was four very interesting perspectives on the future. Me myself has, of course, a lot of questions. I won't ask all of them because we can discuss the future for the whole time. I know that some of your students have prepared a question, but just one from here in the beginning. Professor Serbunin warned about an expanding of the council in the number of observatory status. I would like to hear a little bit more from you. Why do you think that is not a good idea? And in the same content, I would like Anatoly and maybe Elena to philosophy a little bit. How could the Arctic Council, which kind of role do you see would play in the future?
My point is actually very simple. The problem is that even the existing observers, they do quite a little in terms of activities in the Arctic region. For example, when China, Japan, South Korea, India, Singapore, they were on their way to the getting that kind of status, they promised a lot. But they didn't deliver the promises. And also the old observers, they also didn't contribute a lot to the activities of the Arctic Council. Let me remind you that in 2011, the special criteria was established for who can be a permanent observer in the Arctic Council and what they should do. Actually, none of the newcomers fulfill these criteria.
Would you also like Mr. Serbunin to say a few words in which role you mean Arctic Council to play in the future?
Yes, of course, I believe that the Arctic Council should be the main international organization. Now it's not an organization, it's just a forum, intergovernmental forum. First, it should get the status of international organization with the charter, with the right to take obligatory, mandatory decisions. So I guess if you get that kind of status and powers, it would be a very, very important step forward.
Thank you. Anatoly, would you like to give any remark on this?
Thank you. Very good question. What is the role of the Arctic Council? I talked a little bit with Lana about the Romanian Arctic. And the question is the Arctic Council good for managing Romanian Arctic? And I think this is also an interesting question. Is the Arctic Council best for all, solving all the problems? Is it best for the government? I was thinking that mainly it's good political consensus based on it, but at the end, many ask, but where are the actions? What's happening? What are the consequences? And I'm thinking that maybe we should think alternatives. There could be many interesting alternatives. And another colleague of mine, Yidra Ungerman, we discussed several projects, and one of them is a project called Sustainability Index, so that you can not persuade companies to act responsibly because you increase the stiffness of regulation, but you can motivate them by doing so, by using some other self-regulation mechanisms. Very often, actually, I study also startups and other companies in business. I know that a lot of companies doing this increase transparency. So, let's say in Telenor, which we also study, two departments, you don't need to give them a budget so that they cut the costs on travel. But what you can do, you can make a list of these departments and rank them and say who is the first, who is the second, and spend the money and publish it openly. What will happen, do you think? Those who are on the worst, they will be performing better next time. So you don't need to have a regulation above in order to perform better. So thinking about this, so let's say it's possible to create experiences for the party companies and where it could be ranked in different performance. And based on this performance, it could be presented, it could be discussed, and then I think the companies will be paying attention to it. So there are other aspects which I think is important to discuss.
Thank you, Anatoly. Elena, would you add to this?
Yeah, that's a great question. In terms of the observers, there are obviously a lot of complexities, and one of the big questions is, can the Arctic Council, you know, at the same time become kind of community UN with lots of observers, and at the same time retain a special place for Indigenous people, and not least the question that was raised earlier about should northern regions and municipalities and levels of government be more involved in there? So that's a, it's also a question of size and mandate. But I think one way of involving the observers ties in closely with the some of the points about science and science diplomacy, which is the work of science that I raised in my presentation, that Arctic science is very, very costly. Many of the new countries are interested in Arctic science because it has a kind of a bellwether for climate change that will impact them in their home countries. And so developing more intensifying and perhaps making more formal the ways in which non-Arctic states are involved in Arctic assessment processes is certainly, I think, a process underway and one that's very important. When it comes to the Arctic Council, thinking about the future of it, I mean, we know a couple of, for the last 5 years, sort of ending in 2014, there was a bit of back and forth on should the Arctic Council be more than a decision-shaping body, should it be a decision-making body? It didn't go very far. The U.S. was always somewhat against the strengthening of the Arctic Council in that way. But I guess if, when we think about the future, if we're allowed to dream a little, I would think that one of the very important role the Arctic Council could play could be decision shaping, not only for the Arctic countries, but really managing to show up in institutions, international institutions, where issues affecting the Arctic, like the Polar Code, the climate negotiations, where these issues are negotiated and debated, and really show up and make a difference there as a sort of unified voice for Arctic interests would be an amazing development.
Thank you very much, Elena. If there is time, I will have a question. But the audience, please. Lars.
Lars Bachstrup from Copenhagen Business School. So you, all being researchers, and being inspired by this room, have research, you know, left the Earth? Is it skyrocketing? What I mean is, so how can we better turn research into policies, reform, change? How do we operationalize all the wise things and things that we find in our research?
We take a couple of more questions before we let the panel. Steve Olson from Frontier.
Yeah, I have a question for Mr. Segunin. Listening to your foresight about the Arctic Council is very interesting. The Barents Cooperation has the Barents Council as their highest level, which is the ministers of four countries. And then we have the Regional Cooperation, where political leaders from 13 different countries in Norway, Sweden, Finland, and Russia takes part. After establishing such an Arctic organization, Arctic Council organization, would it be natural also to have the cooperation on the regional level?
Thank you very much. Any more questions here? There's one more.
Issues today concerning Arctic and scenarios of development. Can you just briefly name several of the most important and successful factors of the successful development of the Arctic region? Because as we know, there are sometimes conflict situations which we cannot predict, but I think it is very important to just